question I'm going to ask, and I'll give you the scripture for it, so everybody will be on the same page. The question is, what do you consider the greatest indications of Moses' complete surrender to the will of God? What do you consider the greatest indications of Moses' complete surrender to the will of God? All right, so this lesson is concerning Moses, and that particular question refers to the call of Moses. And we want to give you the scripture. This is a Hebrew scripture. This is found in Hebrews 11:5. Moses was an excellent example of one who understood God's ways and had God's interest at heart. He was a servant of the Lord. And the scripture that shows that Moses was a servant of the Lord is found in Hebrews 3:5. But we want to focus more on Hebrews 11:25, and that was when Moses made a decision to respond to God's call. Hebrews 11:25 says, "Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ," this is the 26th verse, "esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook," this is the 27th verse, "by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible." We all know that Moses, when he was called to answer that very important call, we know that he responded the very same way as most of us respond today when we are called upon to carry out God's will. And Moses, we all know that he initially didn't feel that he was capable of carrying out that important will because he felt like he was not articulate enough to be God's spokesman. And he had to trust God to be with him in terms of delivering the message that God had designed for him to deliver. So God promised Moses that he would teach him what to say, and he would be with his mouth, and Moses would be able and capable of carrying out the will of God. All right, now, the question that we ask, what do you consider the greatest indications of Moses' complete surrender to the will of God? And that particular scripture is that Moses said, he chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of a reward. And by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him visible. All right, so anybody know the background about Moses in terms of what his potential was if he had remained in Egypt under Pharaoh? What great position probably was he in line for? But the scripture says he became willing, he decided that he would relinquish all of those rights and privileges that was from somebody important in Egypt. He said that he chose to rather suffer afflictions with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Amen. So, what was Moses in line to be if he had remained in Egypt and not, you know, hearkened to God's call to be Israel's leader, our deliverance? Anybody know?
Possibly the next Pharaoh in line.
Right. Possibly the next Pharaoh in line. All right, that was a powerful
position.
Everybody would have created that. But what was Moses' attitude towards that position that was waiting for him if he had chosen to go that direction? What was Moses' attitude? What did he, how did he think?
Suppose he had had the word of God.
He would have That's good. He might not have done it. All right. Okay, that was the case of Joseph. That was the case of somebody else in the Bible. Well, it was probably in most cases in which we had leaders in which God were really working mightily through. Name somebody else in the New Testament. Rahab is another. All right. She faced a dilemma. Okay, but in the New Testament, we have who? You have to make a decision similar to
Paul.
Okay, Paul in the New Testament. Okay, Esther. All of those great leaders, even in the Old Testament, even Esther, all of those were great leaders, but they all had to face a decision whether they would heed the call of God or whether they would be subject to physical limitations of the particular circumstances that they were under. But Paul had to do it the hard way as well. Paul was a great man. And what decision did Paul make? Egypt and all of his worldly ambitions to answer the call of God. And his willingness to suffer affliction with the people of God in order to deliver Israel from bondage. Okay? What type of affliction did Moses confront? Of course, he didn't know all about all of the things that he would go through. But what type of afflictions was Moses was going to be subjected to? Imagine if he could have seen the end from the beginning. It would have been a different, difficult one. It would have been a little bit more difficult. But Moses went through a lot. What were some of the things that he went through?
Protests within his group.
Mm-hmm.
His sister wanted to take leadership
mm-hmm.
from him.
Right.
His brother. Kind of betraying him a little bit,
mm-hmm.
Aaron.
mm-hmm. Yes, right. That's good. He was betrayed by his brother. And he just faced a whole lot of challenges. He faced challenges even before they left Egypt.
Yes.
Okay, that challenge, one of the greatest initial challenges was what? When he did what? Appeared before Pharaoh
mm-hmm.
and demanded that the Israelites be released, and that was because Pharaoh said what?
Who is your God?
Right, no. Who is your God? Who spoke to you? All right, and even his brethren doubted his call. I mean, his own men of all his own rank, his brethren, the Israelites, because Pharaoh made the task of the Egyptians even more difficult after Moses and Aaron made the appeal to let the children of Israel go. They increased the bondage of their affliction. And that was very difficult for them to adjust to. So they began to what? They began to criticize and condemn Moses and came against him. So he had a whole lot to go through, so Moses had to be a strong man. But one thing that Moses did that showed his faith and total dependency upon the Lord. And the second question is, how did Moses show his faith and total dependence upon the Lord? Amen. How did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord? All of that comes out in the scripture under the heading, Moses trusted God wholeheartedly. And we see under that particular heading that he had to trust God to be with his mouth, because he was not an articulate speaker. And that was one of his big drawbacks, that he was not eloquent like his brother Aaron, and he just didn't feel like he could adequately convey the message that God wanted him to deliver. And so that was one of his fears. But God gave him courage and strength to endure when his call was questioned and when severe opposition from his people resulted when Pharaoh's heart was hardened and the increased cruelty and hardship were afflicted upon them by taskmasters. So that's the initial way that Moses trusted God wholeheartedly. He trusted him to be with his speech, and he trusted him to give him strength to endure all of the opposition from his people when the king's heart was hardened and the cruelty and hardship of the people became more difficult. So that was one of the ways. Also, Moses trusted in God for Israel's release from Egypt. And this is what the scripture says, that there arose not a prophet, and this is found in Deuteronomy 34, 10, 12. This shows Moses trusting God for Israel's release from Egypt. If you want to turn to Deuteronomy 34, 10, 12, if we had the book, we could just follow that, because all of this information is in the book. 34:10, and there arose not a prophet since in Egypt like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, in all of the signs and the wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all of his servants and to all of his land, and in all that mighty land, and in all the great terror which Moses showed in the sight of all Israel. So we can see that Moses was like no other prophet. The Bible says there hasn't ever been a prophet like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Okay, what does that say about Moses, God knowing him face to face? What does that bespeaks? God knowing you face to face. You know by God face to face, that means something.
He was humble.
Right. He was very, very, very what? Humble. That shows his trust in God. He was very humble, and he had a very close what? Relationship. He talked to God as a man would talk to his friend. So you have to be on good talking terms, of you have to have an intimate relationship in order to be that close to God, where God will know you face to face. So that showed that Moses really had a very intimate relationship with the Lord. All right, now another thing that shows Moses' dependency upon the Lord was the fact that it's recorded in, I believe it's in the 39th, you don't have to turn there, the 39th and the 40th chapters of Exodus. The phrase, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, Moses carried out all of God's commands, or he performed very carefully all of the commands that God had given him, just as the Lord had commanded him. In other words, in reference to pertaining to the diligence and strict adherence in following every detailed instructions, given by the Lord, it appears in those chapters 17 times, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, he carried out those particular statutes and laws that God had given him. He carried them out. So, if that appears in chapters 39 and 40, 17 times, just as the Lord had commanded, so did Moses do. What does that say about Moses? All right, he was what?
Faithful.
He was faithful. All right, he was faithful. Oh, that's good, he was faithful. And the scripture text says, and Moses, this is Hebrews 3:5, and Moses verily was faithful in all of his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. Moses was a good example of a faithful what? Servant. Amen. So he trusted wholeheartedly in the Lord, and he carried out all of the dictates and commands that God had delivered unto him. So, let me just read this. This is very good, too. I wanted to everybody to hear this. After leaving Egypt and throughout the wilderness journey, he trusted God and him alone for instructions. Listen to that. Directions, provisions, and protection. As a result, God in his manifold mercies forsook them not. In the wilderness, the pillar of cloud departed not from them by day to lead them in the way, neither the pillar of fire by night to show them light and the way wherein they should go. Amen. That's Nehemiah 9. You can turn to Nehemiah 9. That is one of the greatest historical accounts of how God led Israel, how God provided for them, and how God made a way throughout the 40-year wilderness experience. That is one of my favorite passages that I refer to give me a concise history of how God led Israel and how God led them in the wilderness during that 40-year period. Okay, statutes and laws by the hand of Moses, thy servant, gavest them bread from heaven for their hunger, and broughtest forth water for them out of the rock for their thirst, and promised them that they should go to the possessed land which thou hast sworn to give them. Okay, but this gives me a very good play-by-play illustration of how God instructed them, how God led them, and how God provided for them throughout the wilderness experience. One thing that stands out is this, for 40 years, did the Lord sustain them in the wilderness so that they lack nothing, their clothes wax not old, and their feet swell not. And, oh boy, that is a tremendous testimony that for 40 years, God sustained them in the wilderness so that they lack nothing, their clothes wax not old, and their feet swell not. So that shows how God really worked with them, how God provided for them, and it also reflects the trust that the leadership really had in the provisions and the blessings that God, and God only, was able to give them. All right, so now another way is that Moses' prayer for God to show him his way is a classic example of his dependence upon the Lord in Exodus 33, verse 13 through 17. You can just turn there, Exodus 13, 13 through 17. And this was one of those special prayers that Moses prayed, and you can see the contents of this prayer, the content of this prayer in the 13th verse. He said, I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. For wherein shall it be known here that I am thy people, have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, I and thy people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. So Moses prayed that God's grace will go with him, and God had to give him what? Firm assurance that wherever Moses go, whatever direction that God would lead him, that God's grace will go and be with him. Moses wanted that confirmation from God, and he prayed. He said, Lord, if you don't go with me, I just don't want to face all that, you know, all that I'm going to have to be dealing with. So God gave him that confirmation that he will definitely be with him, and that he would not leave him, might have looked to save him. Now, what confirmation do we have that would increase our dependency upon the Lord in terms of the call of God upon our lives? What does God, you know, we're facing very similar situations as Moses faced. It might not be the same call, because Moses was called to lead 2.5+ million people out of Egypt. That was a tremendous call that was placed upon Moses' life. Okay, but what promise does God give us when we begin to move forward in carrying out his will upon the earth as followers of Christ today? What promises do we have? God said he would never what? Leave us. I will be with you always. All right? Even until the what? The end of the world. Go ye therefore and what? Teach them. Amen. Teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And I will be with you. Lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the world. So we have that confidence and faith because God has already spoken and told us that he would be with us. All right. How many of you remember how many times that Moses, I believe you can relate some of the times that Moses actually showed his dependency upon God through prayer? some of the events that occurred that drove Moses to his knees, there were many of them that drove Moses to his knees many times, and he had to pray in order to get victory over those particular things that he confronted. How many remember some instance in which Moses, amen, got his breakthrough, got his deliverance through prayer? Anybody remember what incident did Moses, instances that Moses faced in which he had to get through it with prayer? Anybody remember?
Circle on the cross. When he takes a circle on the cross, and whoever the opponents and circle with us, he can help. I believe he prayed prior to that incident happening, if I remember.
Okay, the incident of the brazen serpent?
Yes.
Because they were murmuring and complaining, and they wanted to inflict harm upon them.
Right.
And Moses got through most of his difficulties through what? Prayer. Anybody remember another instance?
When Miriam got, when Miriam and his sister protested against it, she received leprosy. She got leprosy, yeah. And he also had to pray on that in order for her to be healed.
Yeah. It takes a real strong person to pray for people when they have abused you, misused you, and condemned and criticized and inflicted all types of harm on your life and make things difficult for you, to turn around and forgive them and what? Pray. Moses was the most humble. In fact, the Bible speaks of him being a very, very humble man. There were many instances in which Moses had to resort to prayer in order to be able to deal with the crisis that he was confronted on hand. All right, so we've covered how did Moses show his faith and total dependency upon the Lord. I guess in a nutshell we can say by being obedient to his voice, by being led by the Holy Spirit, and by praying numerous times for help. Amen. So when a person obeys the voice of God, that shows their faith and dependence upon God. And when they are willing to be led by the Holy Spirit, all right, that shows your dependence upon the Lord too. And they had to be led by the Holy Spirit through the wilderness because they didn't know what direction to go. They didn't know how their provisions were going to be made. They didn't know how to get victory over all of those enemies that they would be confronted. And they didn't know how to deal with all of the limitations that they will be facing, even the need for food, the need for water. They didn't know that. They didn't have no other way, amen, to actually deal with all of the crises and the hardships and the challenges that they were confronted, except by what? Faith and total dependency upon the Lord. They had to take God at his word. Amen. That's a good lesson for us today. All right, Sister Smith. I know you know something about that. Taking God at his what? At his word. Amen. Praise God. Now, what's some of the things that we have to face today that we just have to, sometimes we know that we can't, we're not up to the task, we're not up to the situation, we are not capable of solving our dealing with the things that we are confronting. What type of things do we face today that places us in a similar situation that Moses was in? Something that Moses had to experience. How does what he faced relate to things that we are dealing with today? Some of the things that we have to deal with.
Talk about us, and we have to do the same thing too. We can't strike back and talk about them. We have to keep
about some situations like no provisions. Anybody ever been there? Anybody ever been there? I remember when we first came from Arkansas. That must have been in 1965. We had to let, you know, we didn't have that much at that time. We were in a rental house. So, you know, that was a little challenge. We didn't own nothing. We had some furniture, we put it in storage. So we came to Oklahoma. All we had was what we could carry in our car. That's all we had. It was the furniture. I don't know what happened to that. But we came to go to Oral Roberts University. And I remember that first year, it was very difficult. We didn't have any children. And all we had was that, it seemed like 1960, something Chevrolet. White car, and all we had, we could carry in the trunk of the car and in the back seat. And that first year, my wife worked some kind of laundry, some type of cleaners or something like that. Later on, she got another job, but I was working as a dishwasher. That time, some hotel that they demolished, and I was washing those big pots and pans, and sometimes all we had was a can of soup between ourselves and our little dormitory room. We stayed in a dormitory room for a whole year. And it was, you know, of course, we were newly married. Real test, a real trial, because we had been teachers back in Arkansas. We had to give up all of that, and I was enrolled in Oral Roberts University, so we had to do minimum wage type of work. It was very, very difficult, but God sustained us, He blessed us, He encouraged us, and we got through it, and later on, God rewarded us, and my wife got a state job as a social service as a social worker initially, and so she worked on that job for about 35 years before she retired. But it was an attorney that we knew here that went to bat for her and enabled her to receive that job. That was the thing that kind of gave us a little bit more breathing room and caused our needs to be, you know, met without having to, you know, labor on a, you know, 8-to-5 type job. So that was a very humble beginning, but I wouldn't want to go through it again. Y'all can't envision us living in a little dorm and a can of soup that we had to share between the two of us, and didn't know how we were going to make it from day to day, from week to week, and we had to work at these jobs that weren't paying anything initially, but God gave us grace, and He stood with us, and over the process of time, somebody said, we've been made do for a night, but what? Joy comes in the morning. Anybody got another experience you want to relate as to what you have experienced and how God brought you through? Okay, the third question, these are questions at the back of a chapter. We trying to stick with them so that you can see the format that we have. Once you get your book, you can see exactly what we're doing. What can be said about Moses' faithfulness and commitment to his high call? And we can go back to the chapter information. His faithfulness and all of his house. Okay, you can just listen to this. This is see his faithfulness in all of God's house. Hebrews 3:2-5. Moses received the law, Divine statutes, and God's covenant for Israel. he was given detailed and careful instructions for the holy erection of the tabernacle and operation of the priesthood and for the operation of an efficient system of government. See, these laws and statutes and covenants that God gave Israel, they were given to Moses in detail. And Moses was up on the mountain a long time. He was up there how many days? 40 in one instant, and when he came down and broke the commandments, he had to go back and stay another way. Now, who would?
Darn it.
You said what?
Darn it.
That's 80 days on the mountain, and somebody said that it was 80 days without eating.
Yeah.
It was worth it. But God had to reveal all of these things to him in detail. Hey, Moses was a great man. We don't realize what great man Moses was.
Oh, yeah.
All right, now, details concerning various sacrifices. Y'all know in Leviticus, all of those, instructions for offering up those sacrifices. Lord Jesus, detail concerning various sacrifices, laws for holy living, and the observance of feasts were also set forth through Moses. Now, laws for holy living, the observance of feasts were also set forth through Moses. And as I mentioned, the various sacrifices, all of these things God had to reveal to Moses. All right, the reason why God did all of this through Moses, the main objective was to set them apart as a holy nation. And to separate them unto the Lord as a peculiar people. And he wanted Israel to be a different kind of people. He wanted them to be his treasure. He wanted them to be his special people. So therefore, it takes what? It takes laws. You have to put down a whole lot of details, and you have to give people standards for living. They have to have something to abide by, something that will guide them, to lead them, and to something that would give them a pattern or some example to follow. So therefore, he had to stay until God gave them all of these details. Now, here's what the scripture says. All the things that God commanded Moses to do were carefully performed. His obedience and submission to the Lord was unquestionable. The phrase, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, pertaining to his diligence and strict adherence in following every detailed instruction given by the Lord, appears at least 17 times in Exodus chapters 13, 39, and 40. Now, that really challenged me, just as the Lord had commanded Moses performed all of these detailed instructions, and he carried all of this stuff out to the detail. And somebody even said that, I think I remember, it was about 500 or 600 particular commands that were imposed upon the priesthood. They had to abide by about 500 or 600 things that they had to do in the order of their priesthood and serving in that particular priesthood capacity. They had to remember all of these detailed instructions. If they got out of line, you know what would happen. The axe would fall.
Yeah.
And Moses performed not just the 500 or 600 details, but Moses, all of these commands and laws of sacrifices and observance of feasts and all of these and the laws that regulated all of these special events. All of these things were given by Moses, and Moses, the scripture says, 17 times, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, so did he perform these commandments. What does that say about Moses to you? Just as the Lord commanded. Do you know anybody any type of an example of, it's very difficult to find an example of a person that's committed to carrying out God's word to the very letter, detail. And if we do 50% of it, we think we've done pretty good. And we used to sing the song 99 and a half on one.
That's right.
Now, when we, I was thinking today, I didn't have to just mention this, but sin is, and I watched this, that sin is a transgression of God's what? Law.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? That's one way you can look at sin, as a what? Transgression of what? God's law. Another way you can look at it, all of this is in the Bible. I don't have a scripture for each one, but all of it is scripture. And the definition for sin, all of them are in the Bible. One of them is sin is a transgression of the law.
Right.
And there's another scripture which says all unrighteousness is what?
Sin.
Sin. You know, if it's almost right. If it's almost right, it's still what? Wrong. Then another scripture says that he that knoweth to do good and don't do it to him is sin. You know, we hear things like this, but we just let it what pass over. We don't think that seriously about it when it comes to what carrying out every command that God has, that we know. You know, we can't do what we don't know, right? So that shows that it really takes a special type of person to carry out God's word. Just as the Lord has commanded. It takes a special, special type of person. I want to be one of those special people. And it's very difficult to go through the Bible and say, I'm going to, all of these commands, everything, how in the world? All right. Well, I think the solution is to study, to show yourself approved. You got to study the word and have a grasp of it, right? And when you have a grasp of it and then lean on the Holy Spirit and trust in the grace of God, I think that you can do all things through Christ, which what? Strengthens you. So God doesn't want us just trying to figure out how we can just keep from obeying God in every verse. You know, that would be pretty tough to do. So we have to study and we have to get a good revelation of the scriptures. And once we get a revelation of the scriptures, God will lead you by the word that you know, and God will lead you by his voice. He will lead you. He will lead you the right way. You don't have to know every letter of the law. Amen. But you can be led by the Spirit of the Lord, because God will lead you from the inside. He'll let you know when you're off, when you're wrong, when you're right. We can be led by the Spirit without even sometimes knowing exactly God's position on certain things. And there's one more definition of faith that we want to always remember. First, I say it's a transgression of God's law. Number two, all unrighteousness is sin. Number three, what did I say? To him that knoweth to do good and what? Doeth it not, to him is what? Sin. And the other one, a real tough one. Anybody think you can recall?
That's what I was thinking.
All unrighteousness?
Yeah.
Oh, we've said that one, though.
Oh, we said it. Okay.
All right.
One big one.
It said, whatsoever is not a faith, it's sin.
Yes.
That's rough, ain't it? Oh, whatsoever is not of faith is what? It's sin. Amen. God is not the author of what? Fear. The Bible says he has not given us the spirit of fear, but of what? Power, love, and of what?
Sound.
But that always challenged me. I just wanted to just mention, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, so did he do. That is a very powerful statement. I love that. Okay, time is almost gone. At least I had somebody that talked back to me this evening. y'all been good. All right. Describe the extent of Moses' commitment to prayer seen in the various wilderness experiences. This is based on some details we have in the lesson. He fell on his face before God 6 times during severe trials. He fell on his face before God 6 times. And we have to go back into the lesson to recapture those 6 times. We don't have time. He appealed to God many times on the basis of his mercy. Remember that many times God threatened to do what? Just
wipe
up what? Out. Many times. They were at the verge of being what? Destroyed. God told Moses he would do what? He'd wipe them out and he would raise up a nation. Amen. That would be a whole lot better than them. God was sick of them.
Yeah, Moses said if you do that, then the other nations will see it. And then,
yeah.
That's good. Moses always appealed to God on the basis of his what?
Word
and his mercy. He knew the heart of God. He knew that God was basically a God of what? Mercy and love. So whenever he appealed to God, he said, Lord, you know you're long-suffering. All right, Lord, you're full of mercy and compassion. Lord, you can't do this because if you wipe them all out, amen, they wouldn't be, this wouldn't be a testimony for your people. But how could you wipe your people out you brought from Egypt? And you suppose that you promised them that you were going to take them to the land that flowed with milk and honey, and you just wipe them out. Well, eventually he did do it. How many of that original bunch did he? All right, but here's the thing. He promised to take them out of Egypt and carry them to the land that flowed with milk and honey. Now, if he wiped them all out except for two, did he actually keep his word? If so, tell me how.
Their seed, their children.
Okay. Okay, let me see what you're going to say.
I was going to say that that generation died in the wilderness. So
okay.
He wiped them out. You
okay.
Know? They died in the wilderness.
Right. Okay. And but their children,
right.
Age what? 20, what?
21.
20 on back, or
yeah.
Up to 20 or 21. They were the ones that was what? That they were kind of worthy to enter into that land because they had been guilty of a whole lot of the mess, murmuring, complaining, and all of the, the mixed multitudes, you know, all of these people that didn't have the same, you know, values and moral fiber that, you know, that they should have had. So God destroyed them all in the world. I don't know how many millions of them fell in the wilderness, but it was a whole bunch of them that fell in the wilderness. And what caused them to fall in the wilderness? What caused Israel, you know, those over 21 and above to be destroyed? What caused them to be destroyed? All right. It was numerous times which they were, but they committed all of these abominable blasphemies against the Lord. They accused him of everything. They blasphemed God. They blasphemed Moses, the leaders. And they committed so many contemptible acts until God said, there is no way that I can permit this kind of people to enter into the land that I have promised. But God did keep his word. And say what happened was that these people fell in the wilderness because of their word. You know,
their tongue got in trouble.
Their tongue got them into trouble. They spoke their demands with their tongue.
That's why we're quiet.
That's right. That tongue what? Did the job.
That's right.
And all of those judgments that came upon them in the wilderness numerous times, all of them were due to words that were spoken.
Mm-hmm.
It's about all of those judgments that came upon Israel were because of their what? Their tongue. So your tongue is a world of iniquity.
Yeah, so they weren't wanted, they wanted to go back to Egypt.
I mean, yeah, they said, we don't want to go to this, you know, we don't even know, I mean, we did good in Egypt, let's go back.
Let's go back.
Amen. They prayed many times to what? To go back.
Go back.
All right, but it's really interesting. Let me see if I can find that scripture that that showed that their destruction was due to their words. Numbers, Numbers 16:14. It says this. Say unto them, okay, here's verse 27. This is the 14th chapter. Moses spake unto Moses and to Aaron, saying, how long shall I bear with this evil congregation which murmur against me? I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel, which they murmur against me. Said unto them, as truly as I live, said the Lord, as ye have spoken in mine ears, so will I do to you. Okay, as I live, said the Lord, as ye have spoken in mine ears, so will I do to you. So they were carrying out the things that they had spoken. That, you know, God judged them from the words that they had spoken. Your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness, because they'd already spoken, so we're going to die in this wilderness.
Yeah.
And all that were numbered of you, according to your whole number, from 20 years and upward, which have murmured against me. Doubtless ye shall not come into the land concerning which I swear to make you dwell therein, save Caleb, the son of Jephthah, and Joshua, yeah, the son of Nun. And the Bible was very pointed and said that they wholly followed the Lord, Joshua and Caleb. They, W-H-O-L-L-Y, they wholly followed the Lord. That was the reason. The Bible said they had a different spirit than those that fell in the wilderness. They had a different spirit than the other, as others that were destroyed. Moses received answers to prayers 32 times. All his praying in the wilderness, 32 times, he appealed to God on the basis of his mercy, and he received these miraculous answers to those prayers that he prayed. All right, that covers just about everything. The last one was, what was Moses' attitude towards suffering for the Lord's and Israel's sake? And we've already said that he preferred to suffer affliction with the people of God and to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. I wanted to read this before we terminate it. And this is very good. On Moses' attainments and successes, let's bring out some of the bad stuff about Moses. He complained to God 11 times. It's kind of like us. He was rebuked and chastised by God. And by one act of disobedience, he was not permitted to enter into the promised land. Now, that doesn't mean that Moses was lost.
Correct.
All right. Because of the act of irreverence of God and disrespect to the people of Israel, that was very costly and prevented Moses from receiving his cherished dream. So that was Moses' punishment for being disrespectful. Anybody remember how he respected? You know, sometimes people say, well, Moses deserved what he got. But remember, Moses led those people how long? 40 years. And these are only two things that you can really point to, a couple of things that Moses what did that really what showed disrespect for the people of God and for God. You know, David, we have two sinful acts. But we don't judge David by you know, those two acts that he committed that was really bad, one of them was real bad. He numbered Israel, that showed that God didn't want Israel numbered, so that they would put their trust in numbers or the strength, or trusting on the flesh. And the Bathsheba thing, everybody knows about that, right?
Yes.
But Moses, but David was one of the, was the greatest king that Israel ever had.
Yeah.
Now, how many could look back over our lives and say, well, Pastor Hill already messed up twice? That would be a pretty good record. That would be a real good record. If you only sin, I mean, done sin that really were of consequence only two times out of the number of years that you have served the Lord. Amen. But Moses, let me just read some of his attainments. He was Israel's deliverer, lawgiver, ruler, and he was considered Israel's greatest prophet. Moses was called the servant of the Lord 18 times. He talked to God face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend. Watch this. He was one of the two who appeared and talked with Jesus upon the Mount of Transfiguration.
Yeah.
That's powerful. He was the meekest man which were upon the face of the earth, and was highly respected and revered by Israel. People also of all generations speak of Moses as a great prophet and lawgiver. He was a man of fearless faith who held steadfast to his call and purpose by seeing him or beholding him who was invisible. He was permitted to see a limited view of God's glory after praying for God to show him his way and his glory. God did give him a limited view of his glory. He and his writings were spoken of and referred to many times by the prophets, kings, Jesus, and the apostles. He was regarded as the most commanding and dominant figure of the Old Testament and the mediator of the Old Covenant. Moses, a type of Christ, knew the ways of God and manifested the glory of God. God's nature and his ways were revealed to Israel and to the nations through Moses' faithfulness and obedience. All right, Moses knew the ways of God because he stayed in the Lord's presence, talked to God face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend, and worked together with God to bring Israel out of bondage to Canaan. So I don't care what we say about Moses not entering into the promised land, Moses goes down in the record of being the most commanding and the dominant figure of the Old Testament, and he was also the mediator of the Old Covenant. Amen. So Moses was a very outstanding man, and I think that everybody revered him as being one of the greatest leaders that Moses ever, that God ever had, and the greatest prophet that Israel ever experienced. Anybody have anything to say about Moses, the man Moses? I think he was a great man. What do y'all think? What do y'all want to say about Moses? Mr. Smith, what do you think about it?
Trust.
very good. I think that that's one of the greatest faith builders of all, when you can step out on God's word and just see God come through time and time and time and time and time again. And I think that's, whenever you can see God's power in operation, there is no substitute for that type of experience in terms of building one's faith. You can see God working, keeping his word, and standing with you, standing behind you, leading you. You go through it, and when you get through it, you know it was not the result of your own human strength and wisdom. You just have to look back and say, Lord, it was all you, and not me. Okay, brother, what can you say that we haven't said tonight about the man of
Moses? He was destined from birth to do what he was supposed to do.
There you go.
Yes.
He was preordained.
Right. You got to be preordained. You got to be called. Anybody couldn't have done that, right?
No. He was preordained to do that.
Right.
Everybody is preordained to do something.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
Everybody. I didn't want to make it just him. We all are our own destiny.
All right, everybody is preordained or called to do what? Something. And whatever God has called you to do, amen, he will give you the grace, amen, and the wisdom and the ability to carry out that assignment. Amen. So we don't have to fear when we are carrying out God's will for our lives personally, because if God be for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. Amen. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Amen. God bless you. All right. Well, we did pretty good without having books tonight. Y'all did good. It'll be a lot easier when you bring them. Y'all can follow along exactly. But next time, you know, Bill.
We will.
All right. Very good. All right. So, Pearl, you got your book? Okay. Yeah, everything is kind of laid out. It makes it easy. But we did a good job tonight. We really appreciate y'all coming. Amen. I was
inspired. Very interesting, Pastor.
Oh, good. Thank you. Thank you.
And we will be coming on Sunday.
Okay. Very good. All right. Excellent. Excellent. Y'all have to come and help me out. We have others that last week we had a different crew. You know how some people, how people are. Amen. They have challenges and sometimes they tired and this and that. So, but you just have to keep going and keep plugging. But we have a good response on Wednesday. We have about 20 to 30 that come on Wednesday night. So we're going to try to build this. We're going to have one on Wednesday. What time did we say? 10?
10.
Yeah, 10. Okay, well, I'm going to go. We're going to have a closing prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the examples of these great men of faith have set before us. Lord, this gives us to know that if they walked by faith and carried out your will, and you stood with them and blessed them and gave them grace and the wisdom and the ability, even as you spoke about Moses, who was given the wisdom of an angel to judge between right and wrong. Lord, we believe that as you were with them, as you sustained them and led them and provided them and equipped them and gave them faith to go through and to carry out the call and the mission that you had called them to, we believe that so you will do it for this generation today. Father, we place our trust in you. Bless you to lead and guide us and direct us in all of your path and keep us in the center of your will. And give us favor, Lord, in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Carry us from faith to faith, from glory to glory, from victory to victory, and we'll give you praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, everybody said, praise the Lord.